Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions about Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. This week, it's the final episode in our Acteurist oeuvre-view of Jean Arthur. We'll be discussing the final three films of her career, The Impatient Years, A Foreign Affair, and Shane. After that, we'll close with Fear and Moviegoing in Toronto with the lengthily titled William Shakespeare's Romeo plus Juliet from 1996, Baz Luhrmann's MTV Generation Bard adaptation. So stay tuned for all of that. And as we get into these Jean Arthur movies, let's hear from Leonard Maltin. He gives The Impatient Years 2.5 stars out of a possible 4. Thin comedy of soldier Bowman returning to civilian life with wife Arthur, finding trouble readjusting. Director is Irving Cummings. And the cast list, Jean Arthur, Lee Bowman, Charles Coburn, Edgar Buchanan, Harry Davenport, Grant Mitchell, Jane Darwell.
So that was a very insubstantial review with a very, very vague plot description.
Really not much of a plot description. Based on that, it could be one of a million readjustment to civilian life type narratives, but this one does have a very particular slant. The writer, not mentioned at all here, and producer, Virginia Van Epp, is someone that we have encountered before, and we have an episode devoted entirely to her coming up in the future.
Well, she's the associate producer. It was her first producing credit.
And she did write the screenplay solo, right? There's no collaborator on it.
Yeah, and it doesn't appear to be, based on Wikipedia anyway, based on anything. So it's entirely her brainchild. The problem with it, like, Maltin makes it sound like it's, like, the problem with it is it's an uninteresting comedy. I found it very, very interesting. Also very distasteful.
There's a lot going on, and there seems to be a message being delivered that does not strike us very well in the 21st century.
Well, I don't know how well it would strike anybody in 1944. Well, what I find so interesting about the premise of the movie is that it seems to be delivering nuclear family / marriage propaganda before the war is even over.
Yeah, the boom starts early here.
Return to a completely normal, healthy American society where sex is repressed again, everything's restrained again.
Well, as you know, it's even more than that, right? Because there had never been this idea of the nuclear family as such a fully embodied thing until the post-war era in America. So this is right there at the roots of that initiative.
And already the way I'm describing that is wrong, because the movie actually has very complicated ideas about all of those things. Do you happen to know anything? I don't want a whole, thesis here, a whole dissertation, but do you happen to know anything about the sociology of the manufacturing of this idea of the nuclear family in post-war United States?
Oh, I'm certainly no expert on it, but when we talk about that idea that is still prevalent, you know, so horribly prevalent in contemporary discourse, the right in America at this very moment always appears to be hearkening back to when they say make America great again, they're thinking of that post-war era, the 1950s.
That's a post-war era also where everybody was rich, which is no longer, well, comparatively by world standards, and not everybody, just white people. But, you know, it's a very different situation than what we're all facing socially now.
Of course, but that's part of the problem with American political discourse and Canadian and discourse all over the West. People are so unbelievably unversed in the economic underpinnings of social structures that they can't process all of that. All they think of is that all of these images that we saw of prosperity were reflective of upright, dedicated, eager to work population, of course, always coded white, and no world economic collapse underlying that. There was no American expansion all over the place to exploit countries that had fallen into complete ruin and disarray during this global conflict. None of that is understandable to these people. All they see are punching the clock and getting a suburban home, and everyone just could do that if they just wanted to. And the fact that people can't do it anymore is because they've lost that moral fiber of the 1950s.
But back to the nuclear family, I'm imagining this is...
Well, that's all part of it, right? The idea is
some kind of economic unit, some kind of consumer unit. The husband's going to go to work, he's going to have enough salary to look after everybody, the wife's going to stay at home, she's going to buy a lot of stuff for the home and a lot of stuff to take care of it. But the problem here is definitely not one of women having been in the workforce, because that isn't the case here. Roughly speaking, the idea is in wartime, things happen very hastily and a little bit sluttily and irresponsibly, even though people were technically getting married.
Yeah, and Charles Coburn makes a point of saying, well, you know, lots of nice girls did this.
Right, right.
Under the heady influence of all that patriotism and all of that drama of being shipped out and life and death.
And now we have to face our responsibilities and the fact that marriage is boring and difficult and largely devoted to raising children.
Now, that's not Jean Arthur's problem, though, because she's gung-ho for raising children.
I was going to get to the end of that list, and that both sexes, as the term would have been, have to learn how to compromise with each other's essential slash socialized natures in order to work together to accomplish this. It's very much marriage as a duty, but at the same time, it's not that this marriage is going to be sexless, because a sexless marriage is on offer and contrasted to the movie and Charles Coburn's preferred relationship.
He has no problem with what his daughter has done so far. It's only when she takes the step of deciding that she wants to change her mind about it and erase the marriage by divorce, that's where he steps in and completely torpedoes her divorce case.
But the movie is propaganda for marriage in that it wants to both bully and seduce and harangue the characters and guilt and everything, these characters, into deciding to stick with marriage. The ugliness of this, both of what transpires between the characters and the way in which they're being forced against their will to do this thing, to be together, two people who don't want to be together. They're being forced, legally forced, to do this. That's what gives the movie such an ugly and sour tone, quite apart from how you might feel about its marriage propaganda. And it's so full of conflict in that way, too, between the saccharine nature of the propaganda and the sour nature of the drama and its machinations.
I mean, we've got wife beating on the table within the first couple of minutes of the film.
Yeah.
As the courtroom proceedings get underway, it's the grounds for her divorce, physical cruelty.
Yeah, and it's accurate, as Charles Coburn says.
Yeah, he gets up on the stand, says everything she said is correct. No lies have been told here. And nevertheless, I want her to stick with this marriage.
And the deep unease that the movie inspires. And I want to say that I kind of think this movie was a big hit or anything.
No, it doesn't seem like it.
I want to say that it would have inspired a certain amount of unease, maybe more unconsciously, but definitely still quite a bit of unease when these two ancient men, Charles Coburn and the judge, decide together, even though they are not part of this marriage, and even though Jean Arthur's character has been beaten by her husband, nevertheless, we're going to decide together, we're going to put our heads together, this older generation of white men, decide to override this for their own good and legally order them in what they have to do with their lives, in the most intimate possible way.
This is a little subgenre of films that crop up in the 1940s. At any rate, this movie and The Bachelor and the Bobby Sox are fit in this subgenre. In that one, Judge Myrna Loy sentences Cary Grant to date her teenaged sister in a very creepy maneuver from the bench.
And even though this is technically very much a comedy of remarriage, it's also way late.
Did not get into Pursuits of Happiness.
That's for sure. It's also way late, in fact, post-Screwball Cycle, but does echo some other romantic comedies of the 40s, such as Woman of the Year, in this idea that, well, for very different reasons, this idea that women are somehow the problem in marriage and have to be managed and seduced back into it.
And have to recalibrate their expectations.
There's lip service given to the problems with Lee Bowman's character, but the focus is very much on Jean Arthur's character, and it is her father who is maneuvering all of this. So we get to hear about what these problems between men and women having to do with marriage are in the flashback, where Jean Arthur and Lee Bowman meet for the first time in years.
They met, they were involved in the frantic rush to get married for a few days. After 4 days, he had to go back into the army, and they haven't seen each other since. It's been 18 months, and she had a baby in the meantime. She's very nervous about going to meet him at the station. Her dad comes with her. She's pacing back and forth, and when she finally sees him, just not what she expected. He's got this mustache, and when he sees her, she's doing her hair differently. Nothing stayed the same, and they're very uncomfortable with each other. They feel like they don't know each other at all, which the movie tells us is basically true. However, they have this incredibly important legal and moral bond that is indissoluble, as far as the movie is concerned, because they did get those words pronounced over them, and they have this baby.
Yeah, and for purely pragmatic social reasons, the fact is that it probably is better for them to try to make a go of this.
Well, if they can, but once beatings become involved,
then you know that this is propaganda.
Yeah.
But the movie is pretty blatant about that.
It is, and it has an interesting structure to it that makes it clear that it is trying to counter objections, right? So it's saying, during the war, Jean Arthur had settled into a pattern of domesticity.
We find out so much more when they get back to this house and see the situation that Jean Arthur's been living in, and Charles Coburn becomes the, I don't know, psychoanalyst explaining everything that's happened in a way that's surprising for this man of this generation. I don't know, he must read a lot of magazines.
This does owe a fair bit, you know, something that audiences at the time would have understood and recognized. It is hearkening back in some ways to The More the Merrier. In this movie, he is playing her official father. He had played her father figure a couple of times, not only in the fact that it continually references the score of that film with Damn the Torpedoes, Full Speed Ahead whenever he tries to achieve something, but also in the way that he is manipulating everything.
You know what, Dave? As soon as you said that, sparks went off in my brain in a good way. I'm starting to think this movie is a good movie. It's actually a good comedy, because what it's reminiscent of, and the fact that it's borrowing some structure from The More the Merrier and even the character, but it's also doing something so different and so much more unpleasant with it. I'm not sure that the unpleasantness of this movie is actually a problem. I think it might be like one of Shakespeare's problem plays,
yeah,
as they're called, his problem comedies, right? Where little variations on familiar comic tropes and structures are performed in such a way as to make the audience really fucking uncomfortable. And that's the point.
Sure.
It's exploring some of the other things other than make you feel happy and laugh that comedy can do.
No, I agree. Virginia Van Epp was a producer at Columbia. She was certainly, or an associate producer, as you say. She's certainly paying attention to everything the studio was doing in the early 40s, and this is immersing itself in that dialogue, I guess.
And I mean, obviously she is trying to make a hit comedy.
That didn't work.
No, but that's what you're trying to do in comedy, but principally she was trying to write a romantic comedy in 1944 with a wartime backdrop that interested her, I guess. And this is what comes out. And it's not that surprising for the year 1944, really.
No. And as you say, it is a tale of many patriarchs, even more than we mentioned in the cast list, because there's Charlie Grapewin in the movie too, there's Grant Mitchell, there's all of the Hollywood patriarchs are in this movie, basically.
Well, there's these two, the judge and Charles Coburn, are manipulating this couple's life by legally forcing them together when they don't want to be, and when we've seen enough unpleasantness that we don't really want them to be. But then once they get to the hotel, we start rooting for something else, which is that they'll have sex together because they want to, and then more patriarchs appear to interfere with that goal.
So they didn't get the memo. This is supposed to go ahead.
Yeah, and every time Jean Arthur and Lee Bowman try to explain what's going on to anybody at all, they just create more confusion.
Well, yeah, and that is pretty funny. I mean, they're not trying in any way to be coherent or make any sense. They think it's so absurd that they may as well baffle everyone else around them. That's kind of what it comes down to.
But back to Charles Coburn's psychosocial theories about men and women. What are you saying about what's happened to Jean Arthur's character here, Janie? I have certainly heard women of my mother's generation talk in this exact way. My mother's generation is not...
What generation is that?
She is a baby boomer herself. Right. So obviously it's not this same generation, but some ideas carried forward. And I mean, even now I can observe that this happens to some women. She's just formed a unit with her child.
And anyone else around that is handy for helping out in her plans for raising the child.
Yeah, but sex is excluded from it, and she's found a way to... It's not that she doesn't want that in her life, but it's so much easier to have this child-mother unit and have her matriarchal schedule that she has to follow without having to contend with another gender and without having to try to fit sex in it, which is nearly impossible for any parents with small children. Therefore, Charles Corbin is basically just saying to Lee Bowman that if you don't do something drastic, she is never going to snap out of this and she's never going to take an interest in you and you're never going to have a real marriage.
Yeah, and it's even more of a problem in the 40s than it would be in subsequent eras, because at that time, and we certainly see that from this film, for a woman to involve herself sexually with a man also means to give away a lot of her power, right? It's not an option at the time. It is to concede a lot to patriarchy. He is going to be in charge of the house if he's going to be the dad.
Well, yeah, the idea is that she won't take a sexual interest in him unless he manages to produce some male authority, and that will mean sacrificing this matriarchal setup that she's got going. And she, if she can have this sexless marriage with Henry, the boarder, if she wants to, he's happy to do it.
Yes, he does not try to dominate her at all.
And she has no sexual interest in him, so he doesn't interfere with her mother-child unit in any way, or her matriarchal household.
And Charles Coburn does not like this. He is not happy with the way things have developed or evolved with Henry, and he wants Lee Bowman in there to restore the gender balance that he sees as just and correct.
Yes, partly. So there's that ugly side of it, right? There's that ugly side of...
Well, he also thinks that this will be beneficial to Janie because she's been socialized to get a sexual thrill out of deferring to a man. Yes, that's what I'm saying,
because there also is this side of it that he just really... He wants her to have a sex life again.
Yeah, and that's the only... Those are the only terms upon which he can conceive of a sex life.
And her.
Yeah.
And any of them.
And that whole society. That's what it was. Between men and women, anyway. It was gonna have to play out that way as far as American culture at large, you know, writ large was concerned. Could always be exceptions, but it could never be the rule as far as these people would think.
And for his part, we get this talk about, I still want to be in the sky, and hearts in the sky, and feet on the ground, and whatever. But for his part, it's mainly about he has to get her sexual interest, because without that, not only will she never pay attention to him, he will never even get to participate in the raising of the baby, because she's just going to completely take that over and ignore him in every way.
Yeah, well, he's been living an extended adolescence, right?
In certain ways, but in other ways, he's actually...
A very dangerous adolescence, but still.
But in some ways, he's actually learned to take care of himself better than many men would have who had not had this war experience of being off on their own without women to take care of them.
They have to do their own laundry in their helmets.
That's what we hear. So all of this is uncomfortable to hear. We don't like it. We don't like these gender norms. It's all also very, very fascinating.
It's a real window onto a moment in history.
But then we get to the part where they have to relive their honeymoon on orders. It's also interesting what the movie does with Henry, the boarder. order, because on the one hand, he's ridiculous, and he's the only character who voices anything that, you know, some kind of liberal feminist sentiment that we would now recognize, and he's completely undermined in that, but at the same time, he's very much still part of the whole mix the entire time, and his concern for Janie is allowed to be a note in everything, and he's hanging out with Charles Coburn and wondering what's going on, and they together as a unit. He's not launched at the end of the movie like Gerald.
Yeah, he's not villainized.
Woman of the Year. He's allowed to remain part of the family.
Yes, but he is shown to be an unacceptable option for husbandhood. But certainly a likable character, likable enough character in his way, and he has her best interests at heart. So the movie does extend that olive branch that far to the unmanly man. The section in San Francisco, which is a great deal of the film, does have some echoes of the screwball comedy. They are going through this adventure a little bit against their will, but more and more enjoying it as they do.
It, interestingly, until the end, until a certain point at the end, is really more just about whether they're going to have sex. And as we said, there's patriarchal interference with that.
Yeah, going the other way.
And they are both so, particularly Jean Arthur, more and more, starting with the more the merrier, because you said you didn't associate this with her, like, say, Margaret Sullivan in Shop Around the Corner. But again, as in the more the merrier, she's a very, very cranky character.
and also very horny, ultimately.
True. She is very cranky and very horny. We're not taken along on a journey of romantic reawakening in any consistent or powerful way. It's not that kind of movie. It's more like constantly frustrating us with the absence of that, wouldn't you say?
To a large extent, although there are little moments between them, and she does manage to convince me that she is very attracted to Lee Bowman.
Yeah, fair enough.
Lee Bowman's an interesting actor. He seemed to have been fated to a sort of other man kind of function in Hollywood. During the war here, I guess he got a couple of opportunities to really be a leading man. We've seen him before, right? He usually played unacceptable options in movies like Love Affair, where he's the friendly man that gives way to Charles Boyer.
So this is a rare opportunity for him to be the other man.
Probably his best movie, the movie I like him in the best. He's still quite overshadowed, well, by a mile, by Susan Hayward, because he is the love interest in Smash Up, The Story of a Woman. He's actually really good in that movie. He's clearly here to support Jean Arthur. This is her last film at Columbia, but they are still giving her her due as the queen of the law temporarily. Rita Hayworth will take complete charge of that title as soon as she steps down.
It's always a question whether a leading lady benefits more from, or in a particular case, wants a male co-star who is a star in his own right.
It depends on the kind of movie it is.
To cast further luster on her, or whether it's a Betty Davis who who'd prefer to just have a George Brent supporting her most of the time.
She wasn't too happy with Errol Flynn hogging more than half of the screen sometimes.
Although she also wasn't happy that Henry Fonda, she didn't actually really get to act next to him for much of Jezebel because he was having a baby.
Right.
So yeah, I mean, in certain instances, she definitely wanted important leading men for herself, but in other instances was happy to have a supporting man. But yeah, in this case, definitely the spotlight is on Jean Arthur as a star. So at the end of all of this business, we get the saccharine, well, the first of the saccharine part of the propaganda, which is meeting with the minister who married them, because they're still not convinced yet at this point at all. And
oh, yeah.
They're on their last day.
So this is the patriarch that strikes the ideal balance here.
And a matriarch actually gets invited, importantly, into the scene here to propagandize on behalf of her own oppression.
So this is Davenport, everyone's favorite grandpa, and Jane Darwell, who we've seen several times lately, and most emphatically in Devil and Daniel Webster as Ma. Here she is a much softer Ma character. And they just talk about how wonderful it is to grow old together.
And of course, it's very, very sentimentally manipulative that these two young cynics are here about to make this decision to end their marriage, their impulsive marriage. The minister thinks that they're there to thank him for, or I don't know what he is, justice of the peace. Anyway, he thinks that they're there to thank him for marrying them. They just are so happily married that they think fondly back on the man who performed the service.
Right. And he says that they don't feel this way about everybody, right? They remembered this couple as one of the ones that was going to make it.
And I mean, you just can't, how can you possibly break the heart of this couple?
No, they have to at least keep up the facade. And by the time they leave there, they're kind of sold.
They are. The propaganda has worked.
However, the other patriarchs and Henry at that point are working against them. The FBI is brought in. I mean, that's another callback to More the Merrier, the FBI getting involved, arresting everybody in the middle of the romantic denouement.
Right. And then there's this whole thing about, it's like a bookend of ideas.
In this case, it's the military police, but whatever, government enforcers interrupting the romantic pairing.
And then there's this bookending of ideas about male violence. That's interesting. Stanley Cavell touches on this now and then. I can't remember what particular essay, but it's like the movie has to exorcise this idea of, like the dark negative side of this machismo that it wants this husband to possess, right?
Well, it must come up in the Philadelphia Story essay, I would think, because there's some beating going on in there.
No, I don't think so. I think he's fine with that. But I don't, oh, he's I fine with that? I don't remember. We're rereading Pursuits of Happiness in a few months.
Well, that's right. It's going to be a special subject.
We'll find out then. But anyway, so this specter again of the violent husband, which I think what's happening here is that there's like a, because it's supposed to be their wedding night, right? And so there's this idea of him poisoning her and him murdering her. So I think the specter that's being raised here is the movie's subtextual, but very important, as we've been talking about, foundational association of male sexuality with violence.
There's no question.
And it has to be brought up and then turned into this dark joke so that it can be exorcised. Because, as we've been saying, the only thing she's capable of finding sexually attractive is this brutality and dominance.
Yeah, someone who's a bit of a threat.
Yeah.
It's a very disturbing...
And then Charles Coburn comes back to actually say the words, okay, yes, a one-time beating in exceptional circumstances, look the other way. So yeah. So that you can, maintain your marriage for the sake of the child. But he said, what does he say? You shouldn't be carrying loyalty to the point of stupidity? I can't remember exactly the words that he uses, but...
Well, he thinks that she is trying to make excuses for Lee Bowman trying to smother her with a pillow.
Yes. Yeah.
It's like, okay, no, that's not the lesson I was trying to teach you here.
So I think this is actually a great comedy.
Well,
I mean, it's not funny, but that's not the point. Like, comedy can be so many different things, as we've been saying. It's a dark comedy about sex and marriage and gender, which is one of the main topics of comedy always.
From the mind of Virginia Van Upp.
You can certainly see some kind of continuity with Gilda, which is, I think, the best. She was involved with a few good movies, but maybe the best movie she was involved with.
Not Cover Girl.
That might be my personal favorite, though. We're going to be covering both at one point. It's a noir-era romantic comedy, and that's exactly what it feels like.
Watch it in that spirit and see what you make of it. Let's hear what Leonard Maltin had to say about Foreign Affair. 3.5 stars out of a possible 4. Staid Arthur is sent to Berlin to investigate post-World War II conditions, finds romance instead with hot competition from Dietrich. Marlena sings Black Market, Ruins of Berlin, but Jean Arthur's Iowa State song equally memorable in Great Wilder Comedy, written by Charles Brackett, Billy Wilder, and Richard Breen. Director, of course, Billy Wilder, and the cast list: Jean Arthur, Marlena Dietrich, John Lund, Millard Mitchell, Peter von Zerneck, Stanley Prager.
Again, what a strange summary of the plot.
Finds romance instead. This is probably something that people have written about quite often. You've been doing a little research, so you can tell me, Elise, if this rings a bell with you or with any of the commentators you've encountered. This seems to me to be Ninotchka in reverse.
Oh, well, that occurred to me. I don't know. I haven't encountered it anywhere else. I haven't read that much about that many essays on the movie or anything like that, but it certainly occurred to me. I don't know about, well, why don't you tell me what you mean by Ninotchka in reverse? It certainly seems related to Ninotchka.
Right. Jean Arthur is playing the absolutely certain emissary of her culture, which is post-war United States conservatism, republicanism, which is about to take over. The Democrats don't have much more to go before they lose control of the apparatus of government. A lot of her illusions and a lot of her political program is eroded here to some extent by the bubbling up of Eros.
Well, more than that, it's not just the romantic elements, but the political ones as well that are in reverse.
Yes.
Because, yeah, so Jean Arthur, what we're talking about is the fact that Wilder and Brack wrote, were two of the writers on Ernst Lubitsch's Ninotchka.
Yeah.
And certainly it reflects Wilder's politics more than Charles Brackett's. And is more of a political film than Lubitsch usually does, although he has certainly made other political films.
I think this actually winds up being but more pointed critique of its central figure.
I was going to say, yeah, so in this case, it's the American character is the character, the female protagonist character of inflexible ethics.
Yeah.
As is Greta Garbo's communist in Ninotchka. But in Ninotchka, this ethical hero is seduced by the decadence of the West. And in this case, the American is seduced by the decadence of Europe.
Of an American in Europe.
No, it's the whole atmosphere of Europe, as represented by Marlene Dietrich, that seduces them both. It's a very Henry Jamesian style of plot, really. But what's interesting is that, to me, in comparing the two movies, Western capitalist decadence and post-war lingering Nazi European decadence can perform the same kind of seducing functions. I have a feeling you're going to agree with me when I say that, oddly, Wilder, despite Ninotchka being serious enough and deserved enough criticism of Stalinism that it made the Stalinist government very angry, it does seem to take her communist, Ninotchka's communist ethics more seriously than Jean Arthur's Iowan ethics. Although I do think this is a movie that gives some due to this American ideal of democracy, even as it both criticizes the Americans and is consciously performing propaganda for the United States at the same time. So this movie's really complicated.
Yeah.
And really interesting. Do you agree with me in that? Ninotchka is taken more seriously than Miss Frost, Arthur's character.
Yeah, of course. It's a pure caricature that we're getting. You know, courtesy of Wilder, Brackett, and Jean Arthur, who didn't agree with any of the values she is espousing in this film either.
Nor, we should add, was Marlene Dietrich in any way a Nazi?
No.
And it was interesting for her to decide to take on this role, considering that, everyone knew that she was a very outspoken anti-Nazi and had... There are varying stories that one can find on the internet of the degree to which she was helping Jewish refugees, but certainly she was helping.
Well, if she had gotten as close to Hitler as her character does in this film, her plan had been to kill him, right? So.
Well, she was invited. You know, Hitler was a great admirer, offered a blank check to get her to come back to Germany and perform in films there. And I think she had some kind of idea that maybe she would take him up on it just so that she could assassinate him, but then thought that perhaps, no, I'm living my life. And these are two women who did make plans.
To kill people.
To kill men of varying degrees of badness.
They did not like each other. Jean Arthur particularly did not like Marlene Dietrich. She did feel like some of the dynamic that was going on screen was replicated off screen, that Marlene Dietrich thought she was a frump. Of course, Jean Arthur had these terrible self-image problems all the time anyway.
Yeah, it's hard to say. I think Dietrich was always out to seduce all men in her vicinity, so maybe there was some actual sexual competition happening there. But also, many actresses have spoken to how friendly Dietrich was to them, maybe not when they were in a film together.
Well, not Jean Arthur. But Jean Arthur didn't get along with anyone, as we've established over and over again. Except Joel McRae. That's about it. That's the only... And Roddy McDowall, but she was never in any movies with him. He was just a confidant later. John Oler's book does talk about how Arthur hated making this movie, felt like she was being disrespected and pigeonholed and pushed into a corner throughout the movie, was convinced that Billy Wilder was sleeping with Marlene Dietrich and abetting her in minimizing and marginalizing Jean Arthur. But later in her life, she admitted and talked to people about how she had watched Foreign Affair and loved it, and apologized to Billy Wilder and asked him if they could be friends about 30 years after making this movie, and he said yes, of course. She was crazy.
I think A Foreign Affair, for me, it's not as good a movie as Nanochka.
No.
Because the love story isn't taken seriously enough, but that's for a very interesting reason, which is the moral ambiguity of the male character. So it's not as emotionally involving a movie by any means for me, but everything that's going on in it politically and in terms of its manipulation of these Jamesian tropes of everybody seducing everybody and all of it having some sort of metaphorical significance.
Geopolitical significance.
Yeah, absolutely fascinating. We should talk a little bit about the background of the production.
Okay.
Taking this from an essay by Elaine Lennon on the site offscreen.com, Billy Wilder's Berlin Women, A Foreign Affair, 1948. So she says here, the Paramount film Operation Candy Bar, aka A Foreign Affair, was shot on location amongst the rubble of post-war Berlin in 1948, and Wilder, as a writer-director, whose work now invariably made a healthy profit, was given huge leeway. He had been stationed in Frankfurt and then Berlin during 6 months of World War II, and he had reason to be shocked over the various outcomes of his tour in the summer of 1945. Which had its antithetical aspects. On the one hand, he went to Berlin at the war's conclusion to oversee the reorganization of the German entertainment industry in the role of military government film officer. On the other, he was there to also represent the interests of Paramount Pictures. Now, skipping ahead a bit here. When his tour was over at the end of the summer, Wilder supervised the editing of one version, there were six, of the infamous short film Death Mills, although his was not actually the one that ultimately got released. So this was a film about the concentration camp. It involved lengthy daily sessions of watching reel upon reel of concentration camps with their mounds of corpses, and famously contains the shot of one supposedly dead figure rising up from the pile of bodies to stare into the camera. It is a shocking account of the Holocaust, which the military government insisted be screened prior to every feature in occupied Germany in the immediate post-war period as part of their remit to re-educate the nation of Nazis. During these sessions, Wilder finally got the news from the Red Cross that his mother, stepfather, and grandmother had been murdered and died in Auschwitz years earlier. And this paragraph ends, in later years, Wilder would admit that at this time he'd had a total psychological breakdown and belonged in a mental hospital, not on the Paramount lot. He then immediately set about making Operation Candy Bar.
And this is around the same time he made The Emperor's Waltz.
Yeah, that she also discusses that.
Which is a crazy movie.
She says here, much of the frankly bizarre narrative of the musical deals with miscegenation and a canine romance.
Yeah, it's crazy. We'll have to talk about that one on the podcast officially someday.
That movie was Billy Wilder having a mental breakdown.
Putatively normal Bing Crosby movie turning into metaphor about the Holocaust. This one is a little bit more digested as a discussion.
But that's extraordinary considering how closely upon his absorption of all of this knowledge that was so close to home for him is. And when I watched this movie, the thing that shocked me about it and that very much impressed me about Wilder as a writer is how generous, and of course this essay talks about his great love of the city of Berlin and how he could never get over the fact that it succumbed to the Nazis and what it turned into and was destroyed, right?
Well, sure, Berlin was an incredible place in the 20s.
He would very much, I think, have loved to spend the rest of his life working there and living there. So this, at the very least, the Nazification of Berlin really broke his heart.
This movie is pretty frank in its discussion of how much damage, you know, this I feel like does get lost in contemporary discourse where we are still very much alive to the horrors of the dropping of the atomic bombs on Nagasaki and Hiroshima. Certainly much less discussed or remembered these days is what the Allies were doing on a daily basis with carpet bombing raids. I mean, you didn't need nuclear weapons to wipe out cities because they were doing it without those in Europe. And they were starting to do it in Japan as well.
But yeah, as I was saying, what shocked me about the movie was how generous Wilder is to, and I guess this goes for Nanochka as well, the clear-eyed combination of understanding how horrifying the Stalinist government is and yet kind of taking a detached stance on that. Oh, I don't know, taking a larger picture view of it, because this movie does not condemn the Germans, and I mean that was the official American stance. We want to bring them into the fold of the Western world, right? We don't, you know, the democratic Western world. We're not going to make them feel worse than they already do. Wilder himself, with his personal connection to the Holocaust, that he could extend that point of view in this movie so soon after these events. that astonishes me.
Yeah, well, the idea of showing that movie in every theatrical screening of anything that came across the eyes of Europeans at that time and Germans, the only reason you would do that is if you have made a decision that these people are going to be affected by this. They were not in on it in any real sense. The idea is that you might have understood that you elected or were under the rule of an anti-Semitic government, but you did not sign on for doing this at Auschwitz, right?
And of course, as soon as I read that, I was thinking to myself, but I don't know what else they could have done. They did have to educate about the death camps, but at the same time, would that not have created psychological resistance? Oh, maybe this is faked. Maybe this is exaggerated.
Well, it did eventually, but not on a significant level. These have always been cranks. I mean, we're getting more cranks now that we're pretty far off from it.
But I mean, even in Germany, people accepted.
They certainly accepted it in Germany. I mean, there was pretty universal assent to anti-Nazi laws in Germany that were passed immediately, right? I mean, to have a swastika anywhere in Germany at that time was treason. So, and I don't think there was a lot of resistance to that.
It was funny because you'd think there would be that, but I guess you could just take refuge in the fact that you weren't in on it, that you didn't know. But Marlene Dietrich's character, well, I mean, who knows? Who knows what she knew?
But this movie does, as you say, it takes some really serious chances here because it throws a lot of sympathy toward Marlene Dietrich's character, and she is a Nazi. At the very least, she had no qualms about involving herself on a daily basis with Nazi rallies and soirees and important functions. And even worse than that, you know, from a traditional Hollywood storytelling perspective, John Lund, our American intelligence officer, is involved in a serious cover-up of... Now, he didn't quite understand exactly how much he was covering up, but still...
Nor did he care to find out.
He didn't care at all. Totally white. Washes her record just to keep on sleeping with her, and this is our hero.
Exactly, that's what I'm saying. That's why it can't possibly be as affecting as a love story as Nanochka.
You could say that, but on the other hand, you could say that makes it an even more intense redemption story, right? Because he does start to feel appalled by what he's done when he finds out the true extent of her involvement with Nazi brass.
Well, then something's wrong with Wilder's direction, because it is not nearly as affecting a love story.
No, it isn't. It isn't.
Yeah, he can do affecting love stories sometimes. I think The Apartment is one.
The Apartment is very much. Yeah.
Because the problem is not that Jean Arthur's character is so broad, because very much so is Greta Garbo's character in Nanochka. So broadly comic.
They both basically say suppress it a lot. And Garbo literally, and Jean Arthur in a bunch of corny ways.
This is the third time that Arthur plays this kind of prissy, repressed, cranky character who wants to run everybody's lives.
And now she's got the power to do it because she is an important member of the U.S. House of Representatives.
Yeah, so this gets started in the More the Merrier and sticks with her because that was a very big hit film. And everything I've read about this film, Arthur's character is taken to stand in for her Capra persona, and it's...
No, of course not.
Not at all. No, not at all.
That's ridiculous. Who said that?
I think it comes up in this essay, and
well, that's wrong. I'm sorry.
I've read it in some other places.
That's really silly.
No, the reference point is the More the Merrier character.
Yeah, the scheduling and the Impatient Years character. You could say it's an allusion to that.
And the resistance to sex.
Sure. And ultimately, explosive horniness, too.
True. Very true.
I mean, she's doing that in all three of these latter career films. That's not nearly as much in evidence. Capra doesn't use her that way.
No.
She is the worldly voice of reason character. I mean, she's more akin to the John Lund character in Capra.
To finish what we were saying about Dietrich's character, though, I guess she's sort of Berlin the whore. Berlin, the beautiful, seductive Berlin that allowed itself to be compromised by the Nazis to one degree or another.
You know, Weimar, we think it's so fun and freewheeling and avant-garde, but did they actually become amoral to the point where they either helped along or just went along with the growth of Nazism? Because it was a morality-free context.
And he leaves There's one ambiguous line in the movie where she snaps at John Lund's character for criticizing Hitler. And then you ask yourself, okay, well, does that mean she was an all-out Nazi? She was a Nazi believer? Or does that mean that, like so many of the German people we see in this movie, she has the lingering effects of brainwashing? And is there any difference? In that moment, she seems to have convictions. And she also does talk in that great and greatly delivered speech, Jean Arthur's character. And I feel like, despite the fact, well, I was going to say that it doesn't pass the Bechdel test, but in this speech it does, where she's illuminating Jean Arthur's character about what the German people have gone through. It's a great speech, and it's greatly delivered, and it has an actual emotional and moral authority that maybe nothing else in the film does, and it transpires between the two women. I think it's more interesting, a more interesting exchange than anything that happens between either of them and John Lund.
Yeah.
And she says that in her list of the things that the German people have had taken away from them recently to psychologically batter them, we've lost all our beliefs as well. Like, even if you had a terrible set of beliefs, to suddenly have them completely taken away from you and to be told that they were absolutely wrong and evil, that's quite an experience. And what are you going to build on after that?
State building operation was in its infancy there. And to make it even more confusing in Berlin, I mean, it was happening from two completely opposite political directions. So they split Germany in two and they split Berlin in two. There was East Berlin and West Berlin. So half of Berlin was being told that they were now all communists, and the other half were told that they had to completely integrate themselves as quickly as possible into the new U.S. capitalist world order. And this was all supposed to be embraced within, you know, a matter of weeks or months or days. They're supposed to embrace all of these things. It's supposed to come so naturally just by playing baseball. They're being forced to shed their authoritarian personalities. That's the point of view of the denazification office. But of course, the movie is very clear that they're just being ordered around by different people now. We have that whole encounter at the office where we see what John Lund does every day with the father and his unruly son, and the father's like, yes, we will beat him soundly, we will torture him or whatever you want us to do. And he's like, no, just take him to play baseball. It's going to fix everything. Yes, my yawl. And it's very broad, but it's getting across this point that the American authorities there, they just moved into the vacuum that had been vacated by the Nazis and the fascists. And just because they call it democracy doesn't mean that it's being
interpreted
that way.
On the plane, there's that great line. This is not the kind of thing you expect to be discussed in a movie in 1948, especially a romantic comedy. But there's that line about democracy versus imperialism. And Wilder is, of course, very interested in the problem of imperialism, and it recurs. There's a later movie that he makes that we saw that was very interesting, all about American imperialism.
1, 2, 3.
Yeah, so that seems like maybe a trilogy to put together with this in Nanochka.
Oh, of course it does. Yeah. That's a great sort of cultural intervention there, because what it's referring to, what it's alluding to, is the very conservative, give a man a fish and he'll eat today, teach a man to fish and he'll eat forever or whatever. That's always brought into discussions to discourage aid and the welfare state, right? No, we don't want people becoming dependent on handouts. We want them to become self-reliant. So we're not going to give them anything except maybe teach them how to do something or teach them to be, you know, good upstanding workers. And that's what that person, it's one of the congressmen on the plane says,
give a man a loaf of bread and it's democracy, leave the wrapper on and it's imperialism. Yeah. My God, that's a great line.
So it's a double commentary there. It's a commentary on imperialism, but it's also a rebuke of the kind of anti-welfare state Republican that you would have seen in the American scene at the time, trying to erode the New Deal.
And of course, a brand is very much being sold here to these people, and they're not just going to get aid. They're going to be encouraged to behave in a way that will make them an ally, that won't make war on America, but that also will become part of the American consumer project.
Well, very much so. They're not making war.
Do business with America.
They have no army left and they're not getting one, right? They're going to be occupied for years and years and years, and everyone knows that from the start. It's really, yeah, nobody's concerned about them becoming an enemy again.
And they certainly don't want the brand that they're going to be sold to be communism.
Well, they know that it's happening on the other side of town.
Exactly.
And there's nothing they can do about that. The Cold War has just begun, and that's going to be an ongoing issue for 40 years.
This movie is just fucking endlessly fascinating. But we should probably, since this is a Jean Arthur series, we should probably zero in on her character a little bit.
Yeah, so she has all kinds of great comedic moments. Again, they're very far removed from the naturalistic, humanistic Jean Arthur that we got to know for so much of the series. But she turns out to be excellent at playing this kind of over-the-top comedy as well. She is just barking out Republican platitudes left and right. She is expressing shock at everything she sees.
So this is sort of, other than the Republican satire, this is sort of the Jamesian, the first Jamesian plot. This movie has more than one Jamesian plot, but the first one is the ambassador's plot, which is that the straight-laced American goes to Europe, discovers an illicit affair, and finds their moral certitudes corrupted by the sexy European atmosphere and its moral ambiguity.
She comes armed with a chocolate cake, representative of all of the beautiful moral virtues of Iowa, which he gives to John Lund, and he is our go-between figure. He is, in some ways, the identification character in the film, because...
Well, I feel like they all are, all three of them.
Yeah, but he's certainly the least broad caricature, so you could figure that a lot of Americans watching this at the time anyway would have thought of themselves as potentially being in his situation.
He also has, for much of the film, more knowledge than both of them.
Absolutely. Now, Millard Mitchell has more knowledge than any of them, and he is our narrator, and he gives the tour, and he's the person orienting all of us, giving us the context at varying points, the puppet master.
Now, of course, what Wilder is doing here, portraying the loose morals of the American occupying army, this is obviously in tension with the propagandistic role the movie is supposed to be performing.
Moral uplift is the mission here.
American style.
Right. But the problem, of course, is that the ambassadors of America are not there because they were selected for their moral rectitude. They were thrown into the meat grinder of World War II, and they marched across Europe, killing anyone that got in their way as they liberated country after country, and they just happened to wind up in Berlin at this point, and now they're being asked to change their entire orientation towards Germany and towards the world and grow some kind of new decent society there that mirrors America's illusion of what it itself is. And instead, what they're doing is, predictably, from Wilder's point of view, again, he doesn't make anyone too much of a villain here, which goes hand in hand with what you're saying before, but he also doesn't make anyone seem any better than they are. This is gross behavior, and the movie does believe it is. I mean, these guys going around with candy bars and cigarettes trying to buy sex from starving German women are gross, but the movie also says, look, this is just, these are your GIs. This is what a normal man thrown into the situation is going to do.
The congresswoman, furthermore, is not concerned for the position that the women are being put in at all. She's just concerned that this
reflects badly on America.
All this loose sex reflects badly on America. That's why she actually gets a real lesson when Dietrich's character explains all of this to her from the woman's point of view.
Right. Now, she is a great detective, and the movie does not underrate her intellect, right? The character's intellect. Actually getting to the bottom of things, you know, everything that she sets out to uncover, she finds a way to do it.
She's a very good Jamesian sex detective, in that sex makes her very alert, and she puts things together very quickly.
She leaves the tour bus, ditches the committee, and goes undercover as a German girl named Gretchen, sees for herself what the GIs are up to.
Various commentators on the movie note that, weirdly, she is styled to look like, in these early scenes, the Nazi Germany Aryan ideal, and is easily mistaken for that.
Well, that's also the Iowan ideal.
Exactly. So I think nobody mentions this that I've seen, but I think a point is being made about Republican values. Where are we at with Republicans and Democrats at this point? Because I know that you have said that it's not all, not the way we would look at it now. Where are we at in 48 with Republicans and Democrats?
3 years beyond FDR. He died in 1945.
And that is the turning point. Like, FDR is the first time Democrats ever try to do anything good for anybody, and almost the last time.
He is replaced by his vice president, Truman. Truman is a conservative, but still a New Dealer, but he's on the rightward edge of the New Deal coalition. He is trying to push through a lot of things that FDR would have also wanted to support, but he's pulling back on some other things. The Republican Party, as we've talked about quite often, it is a coalition, as the Democratic Party was. The Democratic Party had the most conservative people in America in it, in the South, who were just Jim Crow racists, because of the economic hardships of the Great Depression, were willing to compromise on their ideas about getting federal aid and stuff, so they took it, but they were not in any way for expanding the social safety net to people that they didn't want to help. On the other end of the spectrum, you've got aggressively leftist Northern politicians would be in the Democratic Party too, but the Republican Party had lots of traditional progressives in it. First progressive president was Teddy Roosevelt, who was a Republican.
But what you've been saying is that these small town Midwestern values are somehow reflective of the Republican Party?
Well, that's because these parties were coalitions of demographic and ethnic groups. So the Democratic Party was a coalition between white Southerners and Northern ethnics, non-WASP. And then the Republican Party was WASPs everywhere outside of the South. Basically, that's what it was. Iowa is just all WASPs, and it's not in the South, so it's all Republicans for the most part. Not entirely. At FDR's height, he pretty much carried every state, or almost every state. So people did get swept up in this, and the Depression helped people to reconsider some of their values. But by the late 40s, those patterns, those old patterns, were reasserting themselves, and everyone could see that the next election, like 48, everyone had conceded already to the Republicans. And it's one of the greatest surprise elections in the history of the American presidency that Truman managed to win it very narrowly. You get all of those stories about how the newspapers were going to press with Dewey wins, and at the last minute they had to pull it back and put Truman wins. No one thought that it could be replicated, and indeed it wasn't. Eisenhower was going to win easily in 1952, and you get the onset of, you know, a more Republican dominated era of the presidency for quite a while. And the Republican Party, whatever else it was a coalition of people that were critical of the New Deal for one reason or another. Some of them were progressives who wanted to do different things to help people, and others just wanted everyone to be left to their own devices, the way the current Republican Party would like to see.
It's safe to say that these Midwestern values, all this Midwestern values hokum, means far less to Wilder than to Wilder, whose ideal was non-Nazi
Weimar, Germany.
Non-Nazi Berlin. Yeah. Than it does to Capra, even though we questioned the way it's used in Capra's movies as well. It nevertheless does work its magic ultimately on John Lund. That is because of the second Jamesian plot, which is the Wings of the Dove plot, where in order to conceal his affair with Dietrich's character, he decides that he's going to have to seduce Jean Arthur's character. And ultimately starts feeling very, very shitty about this, particularly as he learns more and more about the moral compromises of Erica. That puts him more in the Jean Arthur in the Capra movies position.
Yeah, that's how I see him. He has an existential choice to make when he discovers just how thoroughly involved with Nazism Marlene Dietrich had been, and it just stands out so much from Jean Arthur, who, whatever else she is not a hypocrite. Even when she becomes romantically interested in him and goes all the way, she's very excited. She doesn't change her stance overall.
Sexual repression and extreme horniness is very Millie Teal.
It is, yeah. It would have been interesting to have Jean Arthur play Millie Teal.
I've never thought of Jean Arthur in the Millie Teal role before. I've thought of Jennifer Jones, but yeah, well, that just occurred to me now.
It could have been done.
Jennifer Jones is also very good at horniness. Something that is, I believe it is again in this Elaine Lennon essay, I think she brings it up. Possibly another reason why the romance story doesn't have the impact it should is that, and this is also very Wings of the Dove, to a great extent, Jean Arthur, like Lund himself, is seduced by Dietrich, by what she represents. Although in this case, it's that Arthur would like to have more of it for herself. But certainly she is enticed by Dietrich's sexual glamour.
She is, but she wants to remake it in her own image, which is why she sings the Iowa fight song in the Lorelei Club. And it is a very exuberant moment in her career. Sense of coming to life, I guess, is partly fostered by Marlene Dietrich, who, on the other hand, is very much a zombie.
Because for both of them, John Lund and Jean Arthur, Dietrich is standing in for the allurements of this great other to America, this European other that is so sinful and seductive.
Even more concrete sense, it's beyond good and evil, or that's how it markets itself. So John Lund doesn't feel like he's embracing the dark side by covering up these little things for Marlene Dietrich, because he's just saying, no, I've learned now that the life is more complicated than that, and if she did go on some dates with Nazis, she just did it to get by. That's not a reason to make a villain of her. And then when he finds out that, well, there are some things that maybe should be beyond the pale, like palling around and exchanging little jokes with Hitler at parties, he is re-inducted into the ranks of the moral.
What's so interesting is that he doesn't learn anything new. He just sees it in front of his eyes, and he sees it through Jean Arthur's eyes.
Right, she's the one that uncovers the newsreel.
Speaking of what Dietrich's character is like, maybe I should read you the part of this essay that I left out from the paragraphs I read. One day when he was perambulating about the ruins of Berlin, Wilder noticed a woman picking up rubble outside a semi-derelict apartment building. He inquired of her as to her circumstances. She was living in one of the bombed-out flats nearby with her mother. He asked her if she would be cooking something nice for herself and Mutti when the gas was switched on once more now that the Allies were in town. She responded that she would be putting her head in the oven. So this was his seed for the movie.
Yeah, and I think Marlene Dietrich really successfully conveys that bravura performance, but it's a very over-it-all performance as well. And only through the eyes of these corn-fed Iowans can it seem like a liberating force in the world, because she has given up. That is what she has done.
It is interesting because she is in this destroyed post-war world, she's evoking the spirit of Weimar Germany, and these naive Americans are being seduced by that. I mean, I guess the same way that naive liberal Germans were seduced by it at the time, thinking of it as some kind of mode of liberation, but it was not a mode of liberation. It was a dead end.
Yeah, well, and it was an effect of the First World War to some extent, or to a great extent, right? It was, well, we got beaten in this First War. Everything we were supposed to believe in and stand for meant nothing, so let's explore a more...
Certainly there was political criticism that came out of that time as well, but it was very also quickly put down by the actual Nazi regime. You know, violent Brecht, for example.
Yeah, of course. And as we've talked about on this podcast, 1918, 1919, this is where everything really went wrong with world Marxism, because the revolution was supposed to happen right there. And they tried, and they failed, and they were suppressed. And that was the socialist moment, if they had taken over Germany at that time.
Yeah, and that was Bertolt Brecht.
Yeah, and there were certainly people that carried on in that tradition, but that's not the preeminent spirit of Weimar. Weimar was really more, okay, let's put all of that stuff to one side. We're going to forget about Prussian militarism, and we're going to forget about this exuberant socialism as well. We're going to explore a more blasé, individually experimental mode of existence that understands that politics are very 19th and early 20th century.
What is so interesting about Dietrich as an off-screen person is that she really brought that personal sexual gender experimentation with her from Weimar Germany, but was also a very political person.
But I don't think that was true until the Nazis took over.
Like Billy Wilder himself.
Yeah, exactly. The seeds were still there, and when they realized what, you know, not paying attention to politics wound up leading to, they were reborn as political thinkers. You had to have some kind of political position. You couldn't just say, oh, it's all just shams and silliness and speeches. You know, if you don't stand up to fascism, then that's what you're gonna get. And so that is what determined all of the politics of these emigres. I mean,
they were anti-fascists. And Billy Wilder was not a Marxist, and I don't think Marlene Dietrich was either.
Marxist sympathizer, I guess, yeah. But he was not a communist member.
No, of course not, because
I think he was hoping that they'd achieve something good from a distance.
Right, exactly.
that's you know, probably the same thing I'd be doing.
Yeah. I mean, he had that reservoir of cynicism that was still there, but it wound up leading to different kinds of actions in the post-Nazi world than in the Weimar world, where the whole idea was a smart person doesn't pay any attention to any of that nonsense, because it's all games and nothing really changes anyway, and nothing good ever gets accomplished.
What we get with this speech and this transformation, this is the real moment of transformation for Jean Arthur's character, where she becomes a serious person, finally, and not her attempt to sexualize herself. We get the absolute pragmatism of Dietrich's character in The Blue Angel, her sexual pragmatism, which doesn't really resemble anything Sternberg and Dietrich did in their American films, but it was definitely a symbol of Weimar Germany, but in a, you know, geopolitical context.
Expert use of these icons, Dietrich and Jean Arthur, who, you know, whatever their actual personalities, their personae by the late 1940s made them incredibly available to this kind of meditation on the post-war moment and American imperialism.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if it's true. Was it true that by 1948, all that anybody remembered about Jean Arthur as a comedy heroine was that she was wholesome? Because she'd been in Frank Capra movies? Because she doesn't play a wholesome character in Frank Capra's movies.
No.
But
it's broken telephone.
It is broken telephone, for sure. And, I mean, similarly, like I was saying, the Dietrich, this character is nothing like the Dietrich character in her American Sternberg films.
No.
So it's all a bunch of broken telephone.
But that's how cultural transmission works. Let's hear what Maltin had to say about Shane. 4 stars out of a possible 4.
Really, he gave this a better rating than A Foreign Affair.
Former gunfighter comes to defense of homesteaders and is idolized by their son. Classic Western is splendid in every way. Breathtaking cinematography by Loyal Griggs won an Oscar. Screenplay by A.B. Guthrie Jr. from the Jack Schaefer novel. It was directed by George Stevens. And the cast list: Alan Ladd, Jean Arthur, Van Heflin, Walter Jack Palance, Brandon DeWilde, Ben Johnson, Edgar Buchanan, Emil Meyer, Alicia Cook Jr.
I'd never seen this before. I'm gonna really struggle to do justice to it. It certainly is a very, very critically beloved film.
Yeah, one of the most respected westerns of the period.
Right. But luckily, we're not doing the film. We're doing Jean Arthur, and she has basically no character in this film, so we can maybe fail to do justice to the movie, and that's okay, because this is one of the most boring things I've ever seen in my life, and I can't believe George Stevens directed it. It reminded me of being a child, the westerns that would come on TV on Sunday, and they would make Sunday seem even more boring than they already were. And we can't say anything to the cinematography because we didn't see it in the theater, so we can't even say anything to that.
I think this is a great movie.
Okay, well, I didn't enjoy it at all.
I agree with you that Jean Arthur doesn't have a lot to do in it, unfortunately. It is a magnificent Alan Ladd performance. If we were doing an Alan Ladd...
Is it?
Acteurist overview.
Gonna have to be the person who talks about this movie. I liked the fight scenes.
Well, they're pretty intense, yeah. There are a few different kinds of westerns, and this is the...
Cattle ranchers versus the homesteaders.
Yeah, exactly. This one is set in Wyoming, which is a pretty northerly mountain state.
Do I care about the founding of the American West? I do not. I care about drama.
This movie, it does have a lot to say about state building.
These are well-accepted, familiar, common ideas, and they are in the movie. Does it have a lot to say about them, though?
Well, I think it does. Just to get some of the broad concepts out of the way, presentation of the point of view of the ranchers is, we're getting a more nuanced perspective on it. Maybe as hard to believe as that is for you.
This is post-war George Stevens, and he actually has a grasp of leftist politics. He was also transformed by the concentration camp footage.
Yes, he was. More than anyone. one in terms of the lasting impact on his mood and his approach to filmmaking. Emil Meyer, the main villain of the piece, is not made into a mustache twirler.
Although he is very brutal.
He's absolutely brutal, but he is explaining every step of the way why he's doing what he's doing.
Okay, so the only time I woke up during the movie, because it has no sense of pacing or tension for me at all as a through line through the whole movie, besides the fight scenes, the final gunfight and the physical fight scenes, was this discussion they all have about where the themes of the movie become apparent, the political theme. Like, various things are coming into play here. So the ranchers make their case, which, as you say, isn't presented as one-note villainy. And then the homesteaders opposed to this, the idea that, no, you people did not build America. This was kind of fascinating, this whole speech. You didn't build America. There were Indian traders and trappers here before you. They did a lot to tame this country. So now I'm starting to think in my head, well, that has interesting implications. Like, does that mean that the battle at that point was between the Indians and the trappers and nature itself? And the way they tamed the country was by fighting the animals for the land? Probably true. That's fascinating to think of, this endless hall of mirrors of struggle and somebody becoming the victor.
Yeah, well, if you go back far enough, obviously there was a moment in every part of the world where humans became the ascendant species. But then if you go beyond that, yes, there are various conflicts and stages.
Civilizing means fighting against whatever you consider nature to be. Obviously you can subsume indigenous people themselves into that category.
Well, that was the white supremacist narrative, that they found a wilderness here in North America, and they meant that they found no European-style civilization. So everything that they encountered had to be pushed away or subdued in some way, including the human inhabitants.
I mean, that's always the civilizing idea that you find in all of these Westerns is always really problematic for me.
Well, of
course
it is.
Because of this idea that you're opposed against nature as a category, which is obviously has been very harmful to the planet.
Yeah.
Okay, but then furthermore, the homesteaders, nobody has a leg to stand in this battle, so it's almost an amoral battle. Except that in the end...
Well, it's a political battle, that's all.
The homesteaders make their case, Van Heflin does, that, I don't know, it's like small business versus big business, basically. One person shouldn't be allowed to own all the land. It's better if there's a lot of us owning it.
Well, it'll be more productive. I think you're right to say that it's hard to choose between these people. They're all European interlopers in an area that they have no business being in, really. Van Heflin's concluding argument, the homesteaders' main argument is... The government says we should be here. We have a right to be here.
But that's a terrible concluding argument.
I think it's amazing because it's saying ultimately, yeah, might makes right. And
yeah, exactly.
Might is with the homesteaders, and that is what will happen ultimately.
But what I'm saying about this speech is this endless hall of mirrors of anxiety-provoking hall of mirrors of might makes right.
Well, yeah. And I think that that's a very brave thing to do, to put that into this film. And that's why I was saying that...
So you're thinking that this is... Because I did find that speech interesting. You're thinking that this is maybe an unusual perspective for a Western.
Yeah, of course it is. Of course it is. Because it is taking seriously the role that state building has as the undergirding feature of all of the moral or pseudo-moral debates that go on in this kind of film.
But that's very fair. I still have a problem with it as drama, the movie.
Well, then you have to understand all the masculine codes that it...
Of course I understand them, and I'm not interested.
No, I'm not saying that you don't understand them. I'm just saying that the way it's working with them is really interesting, right? Because it is exposing them all as totally false and constructed. And we see it at every step of the way here, right? These people want to kill each other from the moment we see all of them, but they have been refraining from doing so because there are these rules established where they're going to... Well, first, they're not going to use guns at all, so they're going to beat each other's faces in whenever they can.
My god, that's an incredible fight scene. It was so...
Yeah.
Awful, and it went on forever. I wasn't expecting George Stevens to pull something like that out of his hat.
Well, this is, again, yeah, he is exposing us to the brutality of the world, the way he was exposed to it, you know, when he made his tour of Europe. Once they get beyond that, when they are bringing guns back into it, then again, we see the whole false narrative or plausible deniability narrative that is built into the way these Westerns work, but it's never, I've never seen it interrogated so thoroughly as it is in this this film, right? If you reach for your gun, then the person that you're facing off against can kill you, and then it's legal, right? There's so much analysis of all of that, and there's so much talk about the fact that everyone knows that these codes exist and men are supposed to live by them, and gunfighters, which is what Alan Ladd is, and which is what Jack Palance is, these guys are wild cards brought in to cheat the system, because they will kill you every time. And
so gunslinger, this means a hired gun.
A person who will win the battle to draw first every time. That's what they do. And that's what it's so...
But what is this as a profession?
Yeah, they're mercenaries.
Yeah, okay.
Exactly. They're brought in to any situation by anyone. You know, they can choose and they can accept a job or not, but they're brought in a tense situation between groups of men. People are going to lose their temper, and if someone reaches for their gun, then they're just going to be killed en masse by a gunslinger, because unless two of them face off against each other, which is not the usual, right? You have a bunch of these guys who think that they can do something because they were soldiers, like Elisha Cook Jr., who are powerless in those scenarios.
What are your feelings about this child's hero worship that never actually goes away?
It's amazing, though, because this child, yes, he's seeing the world in a very ultra-mythical light, the way that...
Yeah, this is... Alan Ladd is a superhero, and he is. Like, all the way through to the end, he's a superhero.
Well, yes, but he's a superhero, according to the film, for different reasons than what Brandon DeWilde wants to vaunt, right? We see it most keenly when he finally gets that lesson in gunfighting, right? And using a gun, Alan Ladd just stresses over and over again, you know, shooting straight, that's not what I'm teaching you to do. I'm teaching you to draw faster than anyone else, which is crazy. And you have a lot of the characters say, you know, this is just legalized murder. That's all it is. I'm not gonna stick around here when we know what they're bringing Jack Palance in, because a man has to stand up for himself and will be immediately killed by this guy, every single one of them. Precise intervention in the Western legendarium.
Yeah, okay. I wonder how much of it comes from the novel and how much of it doesn't.
I think we can credit it to George Stevens one way or the other, because this was a big project for him that he moved heaven and earth to create. I mean, it was filmed on location in Wyoming. It was a major undertaking.
George Stevens Jr. says that he brought this novel to him when he was a teenager because he thought it was a great read.
Okay.
A great story.
He was the Brandon DeWilde.
Yeah, I guess so.
And yeah, we don't want to go too much further with talking about Van Heflin, who gives a great performance, and Alan Ladd. I mean, this is the quintessential Alan Ladd performance. I'm a big fan of Alan Ladd. He doesn't get nearly his due in discussions of old Hollywood.
All of what you've said here, I concur that all of that is interesting about the movie. I still found it profoundly boring.
Well, that's your right, of course. I'm not a big Western fan, as you know. No, I do find this an impressive movie. It's not a favorite of mine, but, you know, I gave it 4.5 stars on Letterboxd.
I also always have the problem with these widescreen movies that I can't read the dramatic language of the film without close-ups.
Mm-hmm.
And there are so few of them. And Jean Arthur gets, I don't think, any. I had the same problem watching the Jennifer Jones widescreen.
Yeah, I remember that. I didn't have that problem, I don't think.
I very much have that problem. If I can't understand what's going on with a character if I don't get close-ups.
But you liked Love is a Many Splendored Thing.
I did, yeah. I was able to get around it there. I guess the story interested me enough.
So let's talk about Jean Arthur in the movie.
Oh, must we?
Well, we have to, because that's what we're here for. And this is her final film.
Yeah, and she was 50.
More than 50.
Was she? People are so...
52, I think.
Confused about her age. Oh, it was released in 1953. So if she was in fact born 1900.
Yeah, it was filmed in 52, I think. So she would have been 52. She is the wife of the leader of the Homesteaders, Van Heflin, and mother of Brandon DeWilde. It's a character that, well, the film's allegorical approach to storytelling, I mean, many people have remarked on this, it is taking some of the structure of, you know, the Arthurian legend. If you think about Van Heflin as King Arthur, she's Guinevere, and Ladd is Lancelot. There is this
fine
unspoken romance between them. It's not consummated.
I just felt like so little was done with it. So little.
I don't know if I agree with you there. I do think that there is a palpable sense of yearning going on between the two of them.
Well, I guess everyone else feels that way. I did not palp it.
Well, Brandon DeWilde carries a lot of that. It's a very weird use of a child actor, but he is expressing the emotions that Jean Arthur can't express, right?
I guess.
And when she has her talks with him...
Oh yeah, he's actually in love with Shane. There's no doubt about that.
Yeah, from the moment he sees him. And so is Jean Arthur, right? But she doesn't say these things.
And then her other role is to hate guns and cry about it.
Well, but which... that the film also hates guns.
I know, I can't argue about it, but it's not fun to watch. It's not a fun thing to play, I don't think.
Maybe this is the moment to bring in...
But I mean, this movie was an enormous hit. Like, obviously she could have done anything she wanted to after this and did not.
Jean Arthur's final appraisal of Shane. I didn't like it because I couldn't use any comedy bits in it at all. I just had to act old and worn out, she told Hedda Hopper in 1965.
There's no character. There's just no character. She doesn't even get a close-up to do any yearning.
No, the closest we come is near the end where she has that incredibly long pause where she says, Shane,
and her no
take care of yourself.
Her no gun scene is just shrill. Oh no!
How else are you supposed to play that scene?
No, that's the problem with the scene then. I'm talking about the part where she has to insist to her husband that he not go.
Right.
That trope. It's thankless. It's absolutely thankless, this role.
Yeah, well, she agrees with you. It's the last hurrah for her. And as John Oler says, I mean, she could have parlayed this into, you know, a major career as a supporting actress in her 50s and 60s, but she preferred not to.
There's nothing here for her to do as either as an actress. There would be, but the part is underwritten. There's nothing in it that has anything to do with her persona.
No. I agree with you. If you do like this movie, you can't really like it as a dedicated Arthurian.
The only thing I can say for it is that she's different in her age than, I mean, obviously you'd usually be getting some 20-year-old to play this thankless wife role. And I guess, I mean, insofar as there is this underlying love triangle to the movie, I guess you need an actress of some substance who the public is familiar with in order to put that across, maybe? At least in order to put it across without any actual character being written.
Yeah, and
just her presence in the film.
Strong contribution in that sense, but she does not get to take flight the way that we know that she can, and the way we've seen her do time and time again in all of these movies from the 30s and 40s.
I mean, part of what is, I guess, so boring to me about the film is the way everybody is underplaying, and Alan Ladd and Van Heflin are great actors for underplaying.
They are.
They are the masters of underplaying. But Jean Arthur, that's not something you associate with her.
Interesting end to a brilliant career. We won't say a great end to a brilliant career because, you know, one could have wished that she had, you know, gone out on a more the merrier style triumph, but that's so often not the way things go, and she had other things that she wanted to do, which is appear on Broadway occasionally and
freak out a lot
and back out. She had some TV appearances and TV shows that she also didn't really stick with, or didn't take off. But for so long she had been done with the Hollywood lifestyle, and she finally did make good her escape completely after this.
And then what, she just becomes a Setsuko Hara recluse?
Yeah, but with a lot more animals in her house than, well, I mean, we don't know what Setsuko Hara was doing. But, although, you know, people did talk to her, like, she's not a complete enigma, but everything we hear about is her talking about, you know, killing John Wayne or hating this movie or having a
she has strong
paranoid
feelings.
Delusion about Billy Wilder. All these things. I mean, John Oler talks about how many people were asking her to write a memoir in the 70s, and she produced 5 pages worth, and she's like, hey, take a look at this. You like this? And it was basically like psychotic thoughts about hatred of everybody. And they're like, okay, well, maybe no Jean Arthur memoir then.
Imagine if she had social media and a blog now. She'd be like Courtney Love.
She'd be canceled. So she was, for the most part, left alone because there was nothing marketable that could be done with the thoughts that she was having. And it doesn't seem like she had a terrible life, though. I mean, she seemed to have been utterly satisfied with spending all this time with animals, caring for them. She was not very happy with people, never had been. She had her time with them, and then she devoted herself to other things in the last 30 years of her life. I don't think that's a terribly unhappy ending. I mean, it's incredible that she stuck with it as long as she did and gave us so many incredible films, given her misgivings misgivings about the entire profession from the start. I don't think there's ever been or will ever be anyone else like Jean Arthur, and I think it's been a privilege to cover her career.
Yeah, it's been fun.
Now we must say goodbye. Our next Acteurist oeuvre-view episode will be on a very different character, Dorothy McGuire.
Before we say goodbye for good to Jean Arthur, let's go into our impressionistic top tens.
Very, very impressionistic, because mine, we watched a lot of movies for this, and mine are definitely emphasizing some deep cuts, some movies that I don't necessarily stand by as great, but that never heard of before, and they interested me a lot.
Well, we'll talk about how memorable, just in our impression at this moment, Jean Arthur was in them, rather than how they stack up as movies, one against the other.
Well, I can't do that. So it's kind of a balance of the two for me in these movies.
Okay.
In my order of them, anyway.
So we'll go in reverse order. Number 10 for you, Elise?
The Impatient Years.
Oh, okay. I've got Party Wire.
Interesting.
Number 9?
Too Many Husbands.
I have got Foreign Affair.
Oh, way down low there.
Number 8?
More Than a Secretary.
If You Could Only Cook.
Yeah, you did like that one more than I did.
7?
Party Wire. I like that a lot.
More Than a Secretary for me.
Oh. Interesting.
6.
Mr. Deeds.
Yeah, me too.
Oh.
Unanimous number 6 choice for Mr. Deeds. Number 5.
The More the Merrier.
I've got History is Made at Night.
Yeah, that didn't make my list.
Oh, really?
Oh, well, I just... Spoilers for the next 4.
Number 4.
A Foreign Affair. I agree with you. It's not one of my favorite Jean Arthur performances, even though it is great, but I just love the movie so much. I can't help placing it high.
I've got Devil and Miss Jones. Number 3.
Mr. Smith.
More the Merrier.
Okay.
Number 2.
Devil and Miss Jones.
Oh, I've got Mr. Smith.
I did fool around with the order of the top 4 a bit, I have to say.
Number 1.
Easy Living.
Me too. Easy Living is number 1 by acclamation.
It's just such... I guess it really is kind of the peak of her comic persona, like you were saying. It's just such an effortless comedy. It's got this perfect Sturges screenplay, but also of smooth effortlessness and effervescence to the direction that's all Mitchell Lysen and 1930s Paramount, right?
Yeah. So you heard it here first, and I don't think you've heard this from anyone else who comments on Jean Arthur's career. Easy Living is her number 1 film, but there are so many. We did 10, but I had others that I had to drop that I would have wanted to put on it. So a huge career.
And so was there anything on your list that, other than History is Made at Night that was You didn't put Too Many Husbands on either.
No, but I wanted to, and I wanted to put Impatient Years. There's a lot of stuff I would have put on there if 10 was a larger number, so...
Yeah, so definitely some very interesting little gems we discovered.
And movies we left off include such nigh-universally beloved films as...
Shame,
yes.
You Can't Take It With You.
You Can't Take It With You. We left off The Whole Town's Talking. Talk of the Town we left off.
Talk of the Town was very good.
Yeah.
Oh, we left off Diamond Jim, but that wasn't a very big role for her. I liked the movie a lot.
Well, we left off Only Angels Have Wings, which is big for most people.
That's true. We concurred about that.
And I had a more nuanced response to it than I have had in the past, but still.
I had a less nuanced response to it than I have in the past.
But it didn't make my top 10. Now, Fear and Moviegoing in Toronto, William Shakespeare's Romeo plus Juliet. We won't go into huge depth on this one because we do have an episode planned.
We do?
Oh, yeah, we do. It's a special subject.
Who's yours?
Yeah.
What else is on that special subject?
It's 1990s adaptations.
Did we do Clueless?
Yeah, it's a troika featuring Great Expectations, the Cuaron film, which I love, Clueless, and Romeo and Juliet. Plus Juliet. So that's coming in a few years.
In a few years. In that case, what I'm going to do is what I normally do in those cases, which is just to talk about, I guess, what on this particular viewing stood out for me.
Now, when's the last time you saw it?
I'm going to say 2001, 2002 in a college course. I also saw it when it came out.
Yeah, I saw it when it came out.
So about 20 years ago.
I think I saw it a couple of times when it came out.
I didn't like it when it came out. I liked it more in the college course, which was on adaptation.
I've never seen it in a university context, but
I was really impressed by it at the time, and I didn't expect to like it. I mean, I went kind of grudgingly. Although I did like Claire Danes already. I mean, been impressed by her performance in Little Women. And I actually can't remember whether my so-called life was before or after this. I think it must have been before.
Oh, it was before.
So I had seen it, and I knew her from that too then.
Don't like her at all in this movie. That was confirmed by this viewing. I think she's floundering, absolutely floundering with this really difficult part, and Luhrmann's giving her no help at all. But I'll tell you who won me over this time, and it was Leo. After I watched this, I thought of a really ridiculous analogy, which is Leo DiCaprio and Joan Crawford, in that they are such, I mean, they're so different as personas, obviously, but they are such great, great movie stars that you don't notice how really good they are as actors. And he really carries this movie. He's made to carry this movie. And he manages to do it despite all of the noise going on around him.
The fireworks.
The noisy noise and the noisy visuals. And a lot of falling to his knees and screaming no. I mean, he must have been fucking exhausted at the end of this movie. But he's still charming. And he still does make the emotional scenes land. And he delivers the language well enough. And he looks really great in clothes.
He and Luhrmann would work together again in...
I really like him in Great Gatsby, too.
Yeah, we both liked that movie, which was certainly not the universal opinion on it.
And I hated The Aviator as a movie, but again, he gives a really good performance. He's just a fucking good actor.
Yeah, he is. He's good. A lot of other great performances in this film, though.
None of them Claire Danes.
Pete Postlethwaite. So great as Friar Lawrence. He's my favorite. I mean, he's a great character. It's a well-written character.
He does a wonderful cartoony Shakespeare performance that works very well tonally with the rest of the movie.
Yeah, and of course, some of the comedy, you know, horrifying comedy gold that they get out of the failed FedEx delivery.
Oh, yeah, the ridiculous machinations of the tragedy plot.
Yeah.
One of the most ridiculous tragedy plots of all time. Actually, a problem I do have with the ending is that the plot is utterly ridiculous, and the movie's very Brechtian. Everything is in quotations. There's even the use of a lot of text in it.
Well, they have to print the word sword on the guns and stuff like that. Yeah, right?
It's very... And the crazy, flashy style itself, it's very pop Brechtian. My problem with this is that although it does emphasize the fact that the plot is fucking ridiculous, it's nevertheless a really effective plot, and I don't feel like the ending lands. Like, the bombast that is applied to that final scene, I think there should have been more intimacy for it. And let the actors act. They are two good actors, so let them act. Claire Danes does some of her best work in that scene, and they're still completely overpowered by the nonsense going on around them. The fucking Lee bestowed and all the candles. Ridiculous. However, I think Luhrmann's intention, or one of them, was to make an MTV-style teen movie for teenagers out of Romeo and Juliet.
Well, it worked.
And it worked, and I think teenagers were emotionally affected by that ending. My taste may be too good to be affected by it, but I think it really worked.
Yeah, I was affected by it. I wasn't a teenager. I was 22 when
that
came out.
Well, yeah, teenagers and, you know, college age.
Immature adults. Yeah. I'm what still else? Affected by it. I thought it was great.
I think the movie is also really overpowered by the Mercutio character, which is
He is so good.
Who is that actor?
He really should have become a star, but of course...
He didn't.
No. He's on Lost, I think. Harold something.
And he got a lot of attention for this, too. Harold Perrineau.
Right.
So that reimagining of the character is really successful, and it's a very powerful performance, and any strong emotion that happens in the movie is between him and Romeo.
Yeah.
And the whole Juliet stuff is sidelined. I mean,
That's a reading?
It is a reading. It is a new form of adaptation. Sure. Fair enough. It just means the ending doesn't work so well for me.
Yeah, Harold Perrineau living up to the legend of John Barrymore as Mercutio.
Even crazier.
Yeah.
Even crazier than John Barrymore.
But yeah, it should have been a star-making turn, and unfortunately the way Hollywood works, it just didn't happen. And I think we have some inkling why it might have.
Seems that he's done a lot of TV.
Yeah, he's certainly
and he's,
worked.
He's regularly appeared in movies, but yeah, not a star.
I expected to see him starring in a lot of movies after seeing it, but no.
What do you have anything to add to all this, Dave?
No, I think our more in-depth takes on this can wait until we get to our adaptation Impatient special subject.
Roger Ebert really didn't like this movie and also predicted that it was a movie for no one, not for Shakespeare fans and not for teenagers, and it was no one was going to like it, and
it turned out to be a movie for almost everyone.
He was very wrong.
It made a fortune.
It did.
All right, next week on the podcast, it's Hollywood Studios Year by Year. We're entering the year 1942, and as always, we start with Paramount. We'll be discussing Sullivan's Travels, a great Preston Sturges effort, and The Road to Morocco. Two very different takes on comedy will be on display next week.
I'm going to be watching Road to Morocco through the lens of Ishtar. Although I feel like I maybe in my past, in my childhood, Road to Morocco was on television, but I can't say that I ever actively watched it.
I've never seen it. I've only seen one road movie, which is Road to Utopia, which was okay, but I didn't feel any need to see any of the others. This is the third one, and commonly thought to be one of the best ones, from what I understand.
And I do love a double act, so...
Bing and Bob, next week.